Hi, this is Graham, Jenham's Astro. This is the second video about this telescope, the Skywatcher Starquest 102MC. In the other video, I unboxed and assembled this telescope and we saw how it fitted together. Well, in this video, I'm going to continue showing you some of the features of the telescope, how to set it up, and then we're going to try it out at night and see how it performs. So one of the features I didn't cover in the first video is the ability of this mount to operate in both an equatorial and an altazimuth mode. What does that mean? Well, in the unboxing and the assembly video, we set it up as an equatorial. That is to say, we set this mount so that this angle here of this piece was set to the latitude of our observing location. Now, the idea there is that that kind of setup of mount can be basically aligned with north, and then you can follow stars just by moving one of these slow motion control rods. And that's a very convenient thing to do at night because you only have to adjust one of these rods in order to keep a target in the field of view. But this mount has got a second feature. It can also be used in an up down mode, more like a camera tripod, and that is called an altazimuth mode. And the way that you can achieve that with this mount is to loosen off this bolt like so, and then rotate the mount until you've got this basically horizontal. And then, just move it so you can get a clearer view. When the mount is set up like this, one of the slow motion rods is panning left and right, and the other one is tilting up and down. And that's an intuitive way to use the mount. So this Starquest mount has that option of rotating the axis of the mount so you can use it either way round. So if you're using it as a spotting scope, then this is probably during the day, then this is a more convenient way of setting it up. Whereas if you're going to do nighttime astro, probably equatorial is the way to go. So another feature that's worth experimenting with and setting up during the day is a red dot finder. So you remember we attached the red dot finder to the telescope in the unboxing and assembly, and all we did was attach it onto this bracket. Well, what you'll find when you use a telescope like this, a Maxitov, it gives you a high magnification, but that also comes with a small field of view. So the idea of the red dot finder is to allow you to point the telescope to your target in the night sky, or indeed during the day if you're using it as a spotting scope. But it must be aligned with the axis of the telescope. It must be projecting a red dot onto the sky that is in the same position that the telescope is looking. Now, because the field of view is so small, it's something you need to set up. Otherwise, you can get into quite a frustrating situation where you think you're pointing the scope towards the moon, even something that's big and obvious and should be easy to find, and you can't actually get it into the eyepiece of the scope. So the way that you do this is that you put the red dot finder on to the scope. I do this during the day, always taking care not to point the scope anywhere near the sun, and I focus it, point it towards a very distant object. For example, a telephone pole, a spire, a tree on the horizon, and have a look through the main eyepiece of the telescope and get it such that object is in the eyepiece. And after that, simply look through the red dot finder. Here's the switch here, turns it on. That, as you turn it, it brightens up the intensity of the red dot, and then you should see just about, it's quite tricky during the day, but you should be able to see, especially if you put your hand over like this, gives you an idea of where the red dot is relative to that object, that tree, for example. And then after you've done that, you can adjust using this knob is an up and down movement of the red dot finder. And then this one is a left to right movement. And you can do that so that you can then superimpose that red dot onto the object that you're looking at. You know that you've got the telescope pointed at. Once you've done that, it's all set up, and then you'll find that once you get out under the night sky, you can reliably use the red dot finder to find an astro target. Okay, so hopefully now you're familiar with how to set up the telescope. You've got your red dot finder aligned, you've decided how you're going to set up the mount, and you're basically ready to go. So the next part of the video, we're going to have a look at how well the telescope performs optically, because basically any telescope the main feature is that it can give you good views of the night sky. So the way I'm going to do this is I'm going to try to show you what you might see if you're looking through the standard eyepieces of the Starquest 102. So I'm not going to put any fancy digital SLR or astro camera on in order to do that. I'm just going to hold a smartphone over the eyepiece. And what, in fact, to make that work a little bit better, hopefully, I've got an adapter here which will allow me to clamp the phone over the eyepiece. And all that's really doing is stopping it wobbling around too much. So what we're going to do is we're going to take it outside, set it up, and then just going to video what the camera is seeing. And that should just give you an idea of where it, realistically, what can you see with this scope without buying any more kit. So our first target is the moon. I think it's one day past full. And this is the view you'll get using the lower power eyepiece, the 25mm eyepiece. And you can see that it fits nicely into the field of view of the Maxitov. And then if we switch to the other eyepiece, the 10mm eyepiece, we can let the moon drift through the field of view, this time with a magnification of 130 times. So always good to look at the what's called the terminator of the moon. That's the division between the light and the dark, because that's where you can see the shadows in craters and other features most clearly. But it's still nice to just let the rotation of the Earth drift the moon through the field of view. Now, something different. This is Albireo, which is a very famous double star in the constellation of Cygnus, and the Maxitov picks up the different colours of the two stars very well. So Cygnus is a constellation that's overhead in the northern hemisphere during the summer, and Albireo is at the far extreme of the constellation, symbolising the beak of the swan. So moving on to the planets, if you've got a Maxitov, you're bound to want to look at the planets. And this is the view you'll get when you first look at Jupiter through a Maxitov using the standard eyepieces. So you can just see it drifting into the field of view. You can see the planet is a very bright disk, and it's surrounded in this case by four of its Galilean moons. So the moons that you see will vary night to night, and it's fascinating to be able to work out which one is which. This gives you an idea of what you will see. Now, with the naked eye, you get a better view than this. It's been pretty tricky to capture what this looks like using the smartphone approach that I've taken. So if you can bear with me, and this view tries to show that you will be able to capture some detail on the disk of Jupiter. You'll see some bands, and generally I think you'll get a better impression than the one that this video is giving. So Jupiter, a prime target for the Maxitov. And then surely this must be the best view you're going to find in the solar system. This is the planet Saturn. It's drifting through the field of view of the 10mm eyepiece. And then just to give you an idea, I've used the camera zoom to show a little bit closer up view.
Okay, so what are my thoughts on the Skywatcher Starquest 102MC? Well, it's definitely grab and go. It's really lightweight, you can carry it around in one hand, and that's really what I'm looking for when I want a scope that I want to take outside for a quick look and when I don't want any hassle with cables and laptops and any of the other gubbins that can come with astronomy and astrophotography. I think for the price, it's a good package. You should be able to get some good views of the moon and the planets and a lot of other objects that are well suited to magnetars, such as globulars and double stars. And on this sampler one, optically, it seems to be a pretty good performer. The mount, well, I really like the mount. It's very simple, lightweight, but surprisingly stable, given its small form. So I think it's a new generation mount, and with the slow motion control rods, it's very easy to control the telescope without any particular care to alignment or setup. What else? I mean, there are a few niggles. There's a few points where we can see that it's been made to a budget. For example, this optical tube assembly doesn't contain any feature to allow collimation. Now, collimation being the alignment of the mirrors inside the telescope. Well, that is a limitation, but realistically, what I'd say is, as long as you test out your scope when you bought it, when you first buy it, and you check that you're happy that you can get a good, for example, high magnification view of the moon, then after that, fingers crossed, unless you drop it or give it a good bump, then that collimation, that alignment of the optics, should remain in place. So you haven't got the option to fix it if you do misalign it by mishandling, but hopefully you won't have to. A few other bits and pieces. On the mount, the slow motions, you have to make sure that they're mounted 2 or 3 millimeters off from the end of the attachment point. Otherwise, when you rotate them, the screw here can end up snagging on the mount. But that's really just a small detail. You can easily set up to avoid it happening. Other than that, yeah, I really like it. I'd say for me, as a glasses wearer, 25 millimeter eyepiece is fine. That's definitely gets you started, and the quality is okay. A 10 millimeter eyepiece really doesn't work for me. The eye relief, the distance behind the lens that I have to hold my eye in order to see the image, is just too small. So personally speaking, that 10 millimeter eyepiece is gonna go in the bin, or certainly I'm gonna replace it with a better eyepiece. But at least the unit comes ready to go with a diagonal and two eyepieces, and you have to sort of see how they suit you. So overall, if you're looking for a telescope for high magnification and maybe you're new to astronomy, I think you could go to a good place by getting one of these. I think it's good value, a couple of £100 in the UK, option to set it up in altazimuth or equatorial mode, nice and simple, yeah, worth the money. Okay, so I hope this video has been useful. Please like the video if you have liked it, and if you haven't subscribed to Jenham's Astro, please click on the subscribe button if you'd like to see further videos like this. So thanks for watching. I'll try and do a follow-up video where I do actually take some astro photos using an astro camera, and we'll see then what you can get from a small magnetoff if you take the next step into astrophotography. Okay, bye for now.